In this video, we'll learn everything important that we need to know about Rigidbody in Unity and some tips on how to use it effectively. So make sure to watch until the end of the video so that you don't miss any. Alright, Rigidbody is a component inside Unity that allows Unity's physics engine to take control of the transform of the game object in which it is attached to. So if we add it to a game object, you can see that even without writing any new code, it simulates simple gravity and it responds to collisions as long as it contains a collider. Now right off the bat, you can see that a Rigidbody component cannot be enabled or disabled. Well, this is because Rigidbody is a component, but it is not a behavior. Behavior is a class that inherits from component, and any child classes of behavior can be enabled and disabled in the inspector. For example, a mono behavior. Rigidbody inherits directly from the component class. Therefore, you cannot change it or adapt it, making it rigid. There is also a component called Rigidbody2D, which looks a bit different, but pretty much does the same things, but it simulates in 2D space. Unity uses NVIDIA physics as the 3D and Box2D as the 2D physics engine. Therefore, their method of implementation would be different. Now let's look into the component itself. Let's start with this info foldout at the bottom. If you open it, you can see a bunch of properties grayed out. These are values that change when you play the game. Properties like speed, velocity, and tensors all play into the simulation. But the most underrated one here is the sleep state. Sleep state is primarily used for optimization purposes. Essentially, when the speed of the rigid body goes below a particular threshold, it goes into a sleep state, which means there won't be any physics update when the component is asleep. The component goes to the awake state when a force gets applied on the body, either through code or through collisions. Fun fact, sleep is important. Back to the component, the first option is mass, which is an important part of physics simulations. Object of higher mass can push objects of lighter mass better when colliding. But it does not mean that higher mass objects fall faster compared to the lower ones. This is because gravity is independent of the mass of the body in freefall. The next ones are linear and angular drags. These can be used to slow down your object. So the higher it is, the slower the velocity. This can be useful when you want to slow down your movement, when you're gliding or something. This is followed by a boolean called use gravity. This is obvious. This makes gravity affect this body. In Rigidbody2D, this is replaced with a float value called gravity scale. This way we can control the scale of the gravity applied on the body. Then we have a boolean called kinematic. A kinematic rigid body does not react to any physics in a simulation, including gravity. This makes it so that the transform of the game object is not affected by the rigid body. Next up is interpolation. This smooths your transform. Interpolate smooths it based on the previous frame, and extrapolate smooths it based on the next frame. This can be used to fix jerkiness while moving. Now this is important. You may not experience jerkiness while playing in the editor, but you may experience it when you build your game. So the best thing to do is to build your game from time to time, and if any movement with Rigidbody is jerky, you can change this to something other than none. I personally like to set it to interpolate, and that fixes the issue. Next up is collision detection, and it decides how well a collision is detected in Rigidbodies. Discrete collision is the default one. It is the fastest out of all of these, and checks for collisions every physics update. This is ideal for most collisions. The remaining ones try to predict collisions ahead of time and tells the component to react accordingly. Continuous collision checks for collisions with static bodies continuously. Note, static bodies are just colliders without a rigid body. This can be useful for fast-moving objects like bullets, but it is very taxing. Continuous dynamic performs continuous collision with both static and physics bodies. This, in my opinion, is the most expensive one out of all of these. Both of these are sweep-based. They use a time of impact algorithm to predict incoming collisions along the forward vector of the body. However, this will ignore the angular motion of the body. Continuous speculative, according to Unity, uses axis-aligned bounding boxes to predict incoming collisions. This is less taxing compared to the other two and also takes the object's angular motion into account. But this approach has its own limitations. You can read more about it from the links in the description. So the optimal choice here is to use discrete collision whenever possible. If it doesn't work, then try to use speculative and then go for the sweep-based ones. Just make sure you're not directly affecting the transform in any way in order to avoid clash with the physics engine. And the final thing here are the constraints. This depends on the game you're making and the way the mechanics are being implemented. Constraining across an axis stops forces from affecting the respective transform property in that particular axis. This doesn't work if you are manually rotating the object. Now for some tips on how to use Rigidbody effectively. Tip number one, we can use require component attribute like this at the top in order to avoid a null reference. You should perform all your physics calculations in fixed update instead of update. This is because the physics engine calculates things at a fixed time step and is independent of the frame rate of your target hardware. By default, the fixed time step is 0.02 seconds, which results in 50 physics updates per second. You can change this by either going to Edit, Project Settings, Time, Fixed Time Step, or by changing it directly through the code like this. I recommend sticking to the defaults and only change this if it is absolutely necessary. Tip number two, some commonly used functions inside Rigidbody include Rigidbody.addForce. This function adds a force along a particular direction in global coordinates. Rigidbody.addRelativeForce is used to add a force along a particular direction in local coordinates. Both of these functions take in a vector 3 for the force, so it makes sense to get a normalized vector along the required direction and multiply it with a float value for the magnitude of the force. These functions also have a second parameter called ForceMode. This decides how the first parameter gets interpreted. ForceMode.force interprets it as a normal pushing force and is good for movement, but must be used inside fixed update. ForceMode.impulse adds a sudden force or impulse, which is great for knockbacks and recoils. Both of these take the mass of the body into account. ForceMode.acceleration speeds up the body every fixed update and may be useful for racing games. ForceMode.velocityChange instantly changes the velocity of a body. It could be useful for nitro boosts and speed breakers and stuff. These are just the examples that I could think of while scripting this video. Also, rigidbody.addTorque and addRelativeTorque can be used to add a torque in a similar manner. Tip number 3. You should never try to alter the transform of a game object directly if the movement is based on physics. Since the rigidbody component moves the body by changing the transform values, changing it directly would cause clash and then break your movement, unless your body is kinematic. Speaking of kinematic bodies, tip number 4. They do not react to external forces. This means you can enable it to make it appear stuck on walls and stuff. You can set kinematic to true on collision and parent it immediately if it is moving. Kinematic bodies can still exert forces on other dynamic bodies. Tip number 5. In order to fall faster and jump quicker for platformer games, simply increase the gravity scale and increase the jump force in Rigidbody 2D. To replicate the same effect in 3D, you'd have to add an extra force downwards while you're mid-air. Tip number 6. You can directly set the velocity of a rigid body into a vector 3. You can use it for movement and even knockback effects. However, Unity recommends to not set this value directly as it gives unrealistic results. Which leads me to the final tip of the video. Tip number 7. Which has nothing to do with coding, but with a specific aspect of game design. This is something that I personally struggled with, and that is to stop restricting yourselves to realistic standards. I used to Google how many newtons of force need to be applied so that the player can perform realistic jumps. Well, this is not the case in many games. If you look at games like Hollow Knight, the jump over there might feel good and so fluent. But if you think about it, that jump is totally unrealistic. Nobody can jump that high and fall down quick like that. Earlier, we altered the gravity scale and even set the velocity in order to achieve this unrealistic result. But keep in mind that it does not break the laws of physics, but it does break the laws of the nature around us. I hope this video was useful. If you like this video, please do give it a thumbs up to let YouTube recommend this video to more devs in need. Subscribe if you want more juicy Unity stuff, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care. Bye-bye.